Happy New Year.
Hey everybody, hello, happy new year, and great to see everybody. Lovely big house to start off this 2021. I'm Todd Felderstein. A lot of people have been giving me a hard time because I don't announce myself in the beginning. My name is Todd Felderstein. I am the founder of Smartphone Theater, and I just want to take this few moments to thank everybody. I mean, we launched March 27th, and this was an idea, and an idea that that happened very, very quickly with all of our chaos that happened in the world. We launched March 27th with Gina Acosta's play Airborne. This was really just me calling my friends from the actor studio, my family in the actor studio, and everybody just rising to the occasion and creating this digital, what I call performance space. And that first piece with Gina and Stuart Zolli and Catherine Carlin. And we haven't stopped since. We've had three nights that were black since March 27th. So it's a lot of plays, it's a lot of actors, a lot of talent, a lot of directors, and a lot of playwrights. And this is really the perfect platform for everybody that I just mentioned. So we plan on continuing into the new year. And no, I don't see any time for us to stop, because when we've got something that works, we just want to keep on going with it. So thank you guys to the audience. Thank you to all of my enormously talented Actors Studio family and everybody else, because there have been people from all different corners of the planet that have come together that are not one part of an organization outside of the fact that they're all creatives and they're all in the theater world or in the film world or in both worlds. And that's how we've made this happen. So tonight is their night. Tonight is a night for all the people that we've worked with in the past, or many of the people that we worked in the past, and new folks to come together and do poetry. And we have a theme of renewal, but it's a very flexible theme of renewal. So, you'll be enjoy yourselves, basically. Let me talk to you about what we've got going on. So tonight is the last night, even though it's January 1st, I'm gonna call it the last night of our first season. So starting next week, which is the 8th, that's gonna be season 2. And season 2 is gonna begin with two shorts, both written by Jim Gagan. The first one is called The Next Ivan Sharansky, and it's directed by Kate Kaplan. And the second one is called Faster Than a Speeding Bullet, and that is directed by Jonathan Levitt. And then the following week, we have Home Fires 2. So we did Home Fires a couple of months ago, which is by Joe Keyes. And it's Home Fires 2 with directed by Peter Flood, with the same cast of Lily Knight and Steve Huffendahl. So that is very exciting and terrific. Okay, so let me make sure I'm not forgetting anything scheduled. Tip jar, we always have our tip jar. Oh, huge thanks to you guys for supporting us each week. And it's been wonderful. So thank you guys so, so much. It's your support and your donations that allow us to keep the lights on every week. So thank you guys so, so much. I mean, last week with Bob's, we had an enormous house and everybody was very, very generous. So thank you guys very, very much. And now what I would like to do is introduce our readers, our poets for this evening. So the first we have is Elaine Madsen. So Elaine, come on. There we go. And our second is Hannah Logan. Hello, Hannah. And then we have poetry. Hey, poetry. And Buffy, come on, Buffy. Buffy Shutt. And then Michael Cavanaugh and Shirley Snyderman. And Kevin Kelly. And then Don Norman. Hello, Don. David Andrews. Hello, David and Devin O'Brien. All right, thank you guys. Let me press a couple buttons really quick. And then we're gonna get started. So bear with me one sec, here we go. All right, I'm gonna turn off my video. You guys have a wonderful time. And again, there will be a talk back following. So everybody else, you can stay exactly where you are. And we are going to begin our evening with Elaine Madsen.
Hello, everyone. Weave a measure of fine madness, allowing us to whisper of the mystery by which we still believe we can be humane. If this madness could increase, the tide of it would drown the sanity by which we still keep killing one another logically. The timelessness of the sea is a verse God wrote to eternity, believing that humanity could win. Its certainty bewilders me on days when I am stunned by incidents that prove it's inhumanity that's won. This is about memory. Unasked for memory spurts through a crack in the pavement of the day, or bolts through a knot of unresolve like the jagged smell of close by lightning. And sometimes it just seeps like first light beneath the barred door of resistance to seize us brutally or sweetly while feeding itself on our acceptance of its intrusion. Then it returns to the mystery of its existence, restoring itself while lying in wait for its next decision. There must have been an afternoon I felt I was complete. There must have been an afternoon I could recall as sweet. If there has been, I've lost it in the wonder of this unexpected afternoon. Discovering I have been charmed. When going on beyond all reason, you will need your boots, and you must hold your hand, yes, your own hand, the one with the Buddha's eye. To stay this way, of course, because it might have become one of those once in a lifetime, you never erase and pay the price of forever. If I were young, I might have damned the pain to have the splendor, accepted the cost. But if I were younger, I wouldn't have known what I know now about such a cost. And I don't have the strength to pay it. Reality revealed in evanescence is bearable. But the brilliance of its apogee is too terrible to see. Thank you.
Ain't no stockings. That man don't do nothing with care. Since his first day, we ain't wanted him here. Same crazy is stirring. Can't find no mouse, but the rats still running amok in our White House. Before him, usually calm, no matter who's ruling. Dems, GOP, both look the same. Who we fooling? It's not like you can queer eye the Oval. All new decorations get run past the board AF for approval. Of course, it's not a change of decor. The last 4 years made us sick. It's that bloviating narcissist and his tiny hands. Endlessly, mindlessly, covfefefly tweeting every day a brainless sheep bleeding. Big Mac stains in the library from a meeting with Bannon. After that, we longed for the former worst president, James Buchanan. When she walked in, it dropped 15 degrees in here. If there's a heating bill higher than the one this winter, we can't remember that year. So many memories. To name one, humiliation's tough, but this exit calls for celebration. So here's an incomplete list, though it's rough. A first was a first lady whose priority was Gucci. And how about those photos that showed her fashion sense? A jacket that said, "I don't care," at a migrant detention center. So ironic, such flair. Sadly, he didn't care for Black people as much as he did his rug. Or else he'd have 30 million followers like Obama, likely get more hugs. Not such a stable genius as he ought to be. No intelligence was obvious. No Fauci, no briefings. But hey, person, man, woman, camera, TV, lawsuits, text deletes, celebrations for racist, tiny hands, so many times golfing while the country bled. But sadly, we were never left to wonder what was in his tiny head. We laughed while this joke, this buffoon, this jester, this so-called public servant went on a killing spree, wrapped himself in our Constitution, burned our flag to light his way, and drove a mail truck to flee. We who have been here since 1792 know how easy it is to forget, so are here to remind you while the ink on a new one is wet. Remember these things as the new year approaches. Consider this your warning. We've been here and will be. Signed, the White House Roaches. Thank you.
There we go. Sorry about that.
Hey. Hello, everybody. It's called I Am Marvelous. I am marvelous. I'm marvelous. I'm marvelous. People often marvel at how marvelous I am. I'm special. I'm awesome. Some are in awe because I'm so awesome. I'm great. I'm amazing. I'm beautiful. Look at me. I'm tantalizing. I'm not quite sure what tantalizing means, but if it's good, I'm all that because I'm marvelous. This poem, I'll remind you that I'm marvelous because I am magnificent, radiant. I'm so grateful that he made me so bright and brilliant. I love myself. I love myself. I love myself. It's completely normal for me to love myself 100%. I'm incredible. I'm content. I'm good. I look great in jeans. I make the best hemp milk. Who am I? Hi, nice to meet you. I'm marvelous. I wrote the funniest poem in the history of poemhood called Krispy Kreme. I performed it on Broadway every day, except on Monday and twice on Sunday. The poem was about how much I loved Krispy Kreme donuts. At least once a week, someone who watched my mesmerizing performance will come backstage and bring me a dozen hot, glazed, great tasting, cancer-filled, death-lingering, crispy, stupid cream donuts. I didn't understand it. It was like I was manifesting Krispy Kreme donuts merely by repeated words that were spoken out loud. Every single day except Monday and twice on Sunday, it was like I literally was speaking them into existence. This is mind-blowing. Based on the words coming out of my mouth, I was putting what I wanted into my mouth. Wait a minute. I'm impressive. If I could speak that into my stomach, maybe I could speak other things into my life, like about standing. I'm smart. I'm blessed. I'm happy. I'm healthy. My body's like a well-tuned machine running meticulously. Look at me. Maybe these words are more than just words. The God of Israel gave us power in our tongues, the power of life and death to be exact. I'm a millionaire. I have a millionaire mindset. I live in a $3 million house. I have a $10 million ideas with $20 million smile. Look at my smile. Money's not a problem. It flows in and out of my world effortlessly. I have more money than I need. I'm rich in spirit, mind, soul, and cash flow. Have you heard? I'm marvelous. Maybe if we spoke life into lives instead of death, there'd be a new generation of kids smiling instead of profiling on the internet. My goodness, this poem is so dope. Are you hearing this? My kids are confident and intelligent. My kids don't need a validation from a web of lies. My kids are adorable. Have you seen my kids? They're angels. My kids are beautiful. My kids are beautiful. Genesis and Journey, you're so beautiful inside and out, and you're awesome just like your daddy. Maybe that's the reason if you talk positive to your plants, they grow better. That's probably why you put positive words in a bottle of water. The waters form the most beautiful water crystals. Our body is 70% water. No one talks to me more than I talk to me. Why am I going to walk around speaking negative about myself? I have too many other people that are going to do that. I'm a beautiful water crystal. I have water in my bones. And here's what I say. I'm a genius. I'm rich. There's energy to my words. There's vibration to my walk. If I say my vibration is marvelous, then you best believe I have a marvelous vibration. My blood pressure is normal. My feet feel great. My back is awesome. My head feels better than ever. I am marvelous. My wife is completely healthy. She's walking. She's walking. Do you see her? She's walking. My wife is walking. She's marvelous over there, completely healthy and walking. Look at her like an able-bodied walking queen, Nefertiti, walking, 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 walking. Jiran Masson is walking, and I'm a king. I'm a fine, splendid king. I stress the fine. I stress the splendid. I am marvelous. You know what? Words have power. Words have more potent power than we give them credit. I'm going to stop saying good morning. Because I'm not mourning anything. I'm not sad. I'm happy. I'm starting my day out with joy. I'm going to say, great rising. Today is a great day. This is a day that Yahuwah has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I'm not going to work. I'm going to create. There's nothing weak about my week. It's 7 days of strength and miracles up in here. I'm strong. I'm kind. I'm loving. I'm grateful. I love Yahuwah. I can't lose. I'm a winner. I win. That's what I do. Get my wisdom from above. I'm awesome. Some are in awe because I'm so awesome. I'm great. I'm amazing. I'm beautiful. Look at me. I'm tantalizing. I'm not quite sure what tantalizing means, but if it's good, I'm all that. A bag of chips. But yet, French fries, the skinny kind, because I'm marvelous. I'm marvelous. I'm marvelous. Thank you.
Hi, I'm going to read two poems this evening. The Art of the Striptease. You come early, prepare the room. Your head cocks when they drift in. You unbutton your baby blue sweater, quickening their mood. You're here to show the movie's ad campaign, so you pull off your earrings. Toss one gold hoop to boss, he sucks on it. One you let roll down the table. The others jump for it. Boss and money man watch, rearrange themselves. The others dip to their phone, scanning. Fingertips on your collarbone, you lean back, offer a quick peekaboo of lacy white. Their phones fall silent. Challenge takes its place at the table. You know they feel the heat. You tease off your silky blouse, let it fly, shimmy down your jeans. A PowerPoint erupts on the screen. You thumb the clicker, run the slides. You hook your fingers into the top of your panties. All eyes on you now. You don't mind their relishing your breasts or even your ass, your saucy side dishes. You mind they might see your heart squeezed, your ribs working overtime to keep yourself stitched together. The meeting weather turns icy. The only other woman takes the last thing, your shoes, places them with respect in the corner. You stand barefoot, thong naked. You're close, very close to approval. The air is thin, almost blue, when the meeting is broken. Hang on. An actor, director, producer shows up. Heat-seeking boss missiles right out the door. Hard to the mirror in a ladies' room on another floor, hip bones against the sink. You dream hate. How to get to the table. How to get to the table. You deserve the table. You want to watch someone else, unlikely a man, remove clothing, remove covering, remove volatile content, be deprived of status, be taken apart, stripped. Road rage. Inside Coldwater Canyon, I inch toward Mulholland, a snail, sunny. Podcast paused. Last day out, though I don't know this. Dirt skims the windshield. The air will be cleaner soon, though I don't know this. Until the fires, though I don't know this. Anxious to go faster, I've driven over this canyon a million times. Beat my hands against the steering wheel, check my phone, beat more. I could call them. Cell towers dressed up like sad trees, the traffic grinds. I roll down my window to stare at the Statue of Liberty. Planted ridiculously in someone's front yard. She is not the right size, not the right color, plaster, not copper, no portholes in her torch. She is not tall. Her plaque scratched, but no July 4th, 1776. I slam into park, jump out of the car, rush her, drag her to the ground, straddle her. Her. I hate her. I want to strangle her. I want to kill her. I want to kill her, though I don't know why. I inch forward, though I don't know this. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Michael Cavanaugh. Time is winding down and I'm still around town. I tried to get away, but something made me stay. Those big brown eyes and that pretty little face looking up at me, God, they made my heart race. That crooked little smile, not saying a word, but everything she meant was easily heard. And as I looked at her, I could read her mind. Please don't go leaving me behind. Oh, please don't go leaving me behind. I heard the clock tower striking the hour, calling out to me, hey, what do you say? You got to get to that gate or you're going to be late, and upon no man does this train wait. I picked up my bag and made a move to the right. The look on her face, it gave me such a fright. She tried to hold back the flood of her tears, but the breaking of the dam was oh so near. The breaking of the dam was oh so near. I tried to make sense of what was going on because I knew by now I should be long gone. I explained again why this could never be, why it could never work out between her and me. I was way too old with a very dark past, and her and I together, we could never last. But no matter what I said, she just couldn't understand because in her heart and mind, I was her man. Yep, in her heart and mind, I was her man. I took her in my arms one last time, pressing her lips up against mine. I wanted the smell of her breath and the taste of her mouth fresh in my mind as I headed south. I held her tight, her soft against me, wondering if I would ever be free from lying awake all alone at night, seeing her face, such a beautiful sight. Seeing her face, what a beautiful sight. As I held on to her, the train whistle blew. And from the distant far away, she somehow suddenly knew. Like a flash in the night or a bolt from the blue, the truth came to her without the slightest clue. And as she stared at me, as she stared at me, I could hear in her voice, I could see in her eyes. She could barely say the words. They cut her to the core. You are the man they've been looking for. She said, you are the man they've been looking for. I took her face so gentle in my hands and said simply to her, they've got the wrong man. She looked at me in her calm, quiet way for just a moment or two, then she knew I was true. And when she whispered my name, I heard in her voice, I saw in her eyes, there wasn't any choice. You got to get away, is what she said to me before they drag you down to the hanging tree. Before they drag you down to the hanging tree. She checked a clock tower, looking at the hour, calling out to me, hey, what do you say? We got to get to that gate or we're going to be late. And upon no man or woman does this train wait. She picked up my bag and made a move to the right, grabbing my hand. We must have been some sight. Running through the crowd, we got to the gate, slithering through just before we were late. Slithering through just before we were late. Leaping aboard that slow-moving train, she was coming with me, that was sure plain. Those big brown eyes so crystal clear, that crooked little smile, grinning ear to ear. We didn't say a thing, there was nothing to say. We had a brand new life, a brand new day. And as she looked at me, I could read her mind. You didn't go leaving me behind. No, you didn't go leaving me behind. Finally, she said, and it touched me to the core, you are the man I've been waiting for. She said, you are the man I've been waiting for. She took my face so gentle in her hands, and in my heart and mind, I knew that I was her man. In my heart and mind, I knew that I was her man. I wouldn't have to lie awake all alone at night. I'd get to see her face, such a beautiful sight. I'd get to see her real face each and every night. I'd get to see her real face each and every night. What a beautiful sight. What a beautiful sight. Happy birthday, Bugak. Thank you.
Hi. I'm going to read three poems. First one is called Ode to Joan. The spoken word was Joan's best friend. Sniping and griping went on without end, never shy to respond to a trend, criticizing politics at every bend. Can we talk? Was Joan's famous retort, and her audience laughed at the sport. Celebrities quaked for fear that they'd get caught. Her fame grew as fans gave her much support. An idol of mine, her humor reached heights, her wit and her moxie put her name up in lights. And although not everyone saw her delights, Joan was the ultimate speaker for women's rights. The loves of her life, Melissa and Cooper, the smile on her face will tell you how super. No one dare make a joke or a blooper. No matter how hard, Joan was a trooper. It was a grim day, the 4th of September. Her beloved Joan died in a slumber. And her fans should always remember our tribe had lost a valuable member. Come to the table. Shall we all come to the table? Come walking in. I know you're able. It's time to get to know each other, side by side, sister and brother. What do you want to know about me? What do I know about you but what I can see? Tell me something that I don't know anything about. What can I learn from your smile and your shout? I will share my love of words and learning and my ability to speak love and yearning. Will you tell me about your life and your style? Will I like you better? Will it make me smile? I'll tell you I'm Jewish with God as my guide. Will that offend you? Will you turn and hide? I will tell you I care about humankind. Will you laugh at me and pay me no mind? Come to the table. Tell me about your mother, your father, your siblings, your uncles, any other. What kind of love did you live? How was the harmony? Did you feel necessary, wanted, or not part of the progeny? Come to the table with an open heart. Let's create a dialogue. Where do we start? I'll tell you what matters for blending, if you will follow with words of mending. Let's try to bring anger and hatred to an end. We can even try to be neighbors, make a friend. And when we cannot find another thing to malign, you and yours can live peacefully with me and mine. A year on hold. As the story goes, when all is told, the world had stopped as a year was on hold. Healthcare staff stood strong and bold. People died, wealth declined as the year was on hold. Commerce was shuttered, schools ran cold. Life's a virtual world as the year's on hold. Beaches, amusement parks soon needed to fold. Wear the mask, stay at home, as the year was on hold. Our local sport teams played with few tickets sold in the bubble or on vacant fields, as the year was on hold. The virus went on, mindless of young and the old. No parties, nor weddings, as the year was on hold. A vaccine was coming, a cure would be gold, said Fauci and others, as the year was on hold. We'll learn how to live, create a new mold, looking forward to this year because the last one was on hold. Thank you.
Home call 1536. The toothless men are silent this evening in chairs reserved for the dead. Little John is sleeping, Big Tom is weeping, and St. Paul's holding his head. And the clock on the wall has stopped ticking next to a picture I cannot forget here at 1536. On the street, the pimps and the whores hustle. As the night wind plays. See the cripple on crutches, he searches for the welfare check he has lost. As the skinny black drag queen in leather stumbles out of the bar, they call the white horse. As the lunatic cries, I've been saved in a fit. His wife screams, who gives a damn? Here at 1536. Well, the walls are the color of yellow and the carpet is stained with fresh blood. I lie in bed reading my Bible, dreaming about that woman I love. And I kiss her sweet lips and I tug on her hips, but she's with another man here at 1536. Well, I rise to a dream interrupted as I wash the seed off my hand. I look at myself in the mirror, then I sit by a broken window and I stare and I see why those in the hills look down on those of us stuck in the pit here at 1536. So I wander these hallways a stranger, a prophet of doom, a misfit. A part of me thinks I'm some kind of intellectual. Another part thinks I'm just full of shit. And behind every door, there's a story. And behind every story is a song. Here at 1536. Now the toothless men have retired, but their silence remains in the air. And the only man left is St. Paul in his reserve for the dead chair. As I climb up the stairs, he's singing to me, there's beauty and hope everywhere, even here at 1536. It's called Hymn to the Unsung. I sang to the stoic worn widow in solitude brushing her hair, to the lone missionary of mercy nourishing those in despair, to the volunteer selflessly serving the maladjusted one in need, to the relentless idealist refusing to bow to the cyclops of greed. I sing to the man on the corner, and I sing to the man in the hills, and I sing to you women working both at home and in jobs to pay bills. I sing to the forgotten soldier whose valor led him to a grave, to the bright, illiterate child who has trouble spelling her name, to the drifter wandering aimlessly, never sure where he winds up, to the look in the eyes of a stranger who sees you've seen too much. I sing to the boy with the notion, and I sing to the girl with the glow, and I sing to all you in authority who admit sometimes you don't know. I sing to the modern young artist whose genius transcends what's vogue, to the misunderstood lyric poet traveling the forsaken road, to the idiot savant freak of nature hysterically breathing the air, to the impossibly star-crossed lovers intertwined but no longer a pair. I sing to the golden-hearted people who never found time to grow old, to the rejected, misfitted failure who will always need rock and roll, to the wise and the foolish among you and never learned how to say no, to the numbers caught in the shuffle asking, hey man, which way do I go? I sing to those who've come before me, and I sing to those who'll follow soon. I sing this hymn to the unsung. I hope someday it reaches you. Thank you.
Hello. This is called Hand Jive. Your hand. Your skin, miracle wine flowing across my slow drinking palate. Your bones, swaying bridges, ascending from safely mountain paths into precarious wildernesses. All your pulleys and jigs, all your windy, aspen talking, tremulous red and gold, whispering majestically to my nearly deafness. Your hand, awakening in, waking my hand. This is called Angels. I've never been to Berlin, but I understand they have angels sitting atop Tiergarten, watching, waiting. Probably they are here as well. Perhaps one is sitting on the corner of that building. right? Where the red brick meets the white. Watching, waiting, silent, desire under glass. And after all, what can angels do beyond reminding me by their powerless strength of my terrible freedom? Mermaids are calling. A disappearing art is the making of clothing from the skin of fish, practiced by a disappearing people who claim descent from mermaids. And only the women remember and keep the art alive. Does the feminine heart long for water as the masculine longs for battle? Is that why both are fascinated by mermaids? She desiring the feel of water flowing cool along the length of arms and torso and fins, in flight beneath waves. He drawn by the invitation to leave behind the life of dirt and toil. Both at rest in the deep rhythmic sway of Mother Earth's watery hips, moved by moon and invisible streams, unbound from the limits of shores and storms, at play with she who caresses the stolid island pinnacles and cools the inevitable angry eruptions rising from the core. My own divided heart has heard that call to slip into the stream and rush or amble down to the great well to cease my war and succumb to liberty. Untitled 37. I am open, no closed, no way to move, no broken sense, no facility to broker a way into the world I want to be. So I retreat. Retreat, retreat. I am disorder and afraid. Afraid? Afraid of what happens next. What if I go nowhere? I want to give voice to something, to speak out loud, to be heard above the din, above the din, above the din, to say, what? My desperate child's cry, look at me, look at me, look at me. I want beauty, startling beauty, in every gesture, in every stroke of the pen. I want transcendence. Tree song. Your finger falls lightly upon my skin. So fall our illusions. Like a leaf on a windless day, an unexpected, ponderous meander, brilliance fading to black soil. You think you stand alone, yet our hands reach for the same light. Our thirst is quenched by the same drink. We both suck sustenance from the same earth, made as it is from our bodies. And we have this way of kissing, you breathing out what I breathe in, I breathing in what you breathe out. 50,000 aspen trees are one being, connected beneath the sight line. Your roots and my roots stretch together into every beginning, entwined, whatever the distance between our attempts to taste the sky. What I require of you is what you require of me. to be here. Breathe now. Drink now. Expand now in the light and in the dark now. Contract. Sing our song, root, stem, and leaf. And if there be storms, what is a storm but the passion of dust and breath and fire? And if there be drought or pestilence, what is trouble but the winnowing of chaff to find the seed of the new morn? And if there be the morrow, what is the morrow but another falling illusion? Thank you.
ADHD. My world lives with little ritual. Amoeba-like my path, incessant motion, never waiting for it to change, but does without asking. Simple. Meadow. In vibrant greens, melted molten yellow by the sun, we too graze in a sheep's meadow. Time spinning dervishly so fast that we seem ever present, always, never in shadow. Yet suddenly the dusk descends, no longer a curtain, only a delicate veil. And beneath it feels at once so peaceful and no longer sad that I will place my heart in hands that will hold it. Subway. My boundaries are wide. That is why the weirdos sometimes step inside. I only have a greater sense of me and can live free of fear. Sorrow. I have no expectations, no wants in this moment of sorrow. I have sorrow. It is my breath. It is my blood. It is my food. This sorrow, it will heal me. For Santa. Jerry Lee said 39 didn't have to be so low. Yeah, the turkey gobbler made me warm. No bed need be made. The light went out long ago. Inside, I knew Santa Claus would never pass this way again. Christmas Eve, to be so sick inside with a 29 wind making my eyes water. Still, frozen. A 357 ice. Echoes of sound of foolish feet dancing on a stock pond, ringing, "Good night, St. Nick," on Donner, on Blitzen. I put a bicycle together this afternoon. I wondered how poor people could be. I cried and cried that it was so real, those Takati kids, and these here so stricken with some unknown grief. If I could just play rock and roll, I'd be all right, this bounding and prancing within Santa's heart. So I say, Jerry Lee, spoolie-oolie drinking wine, wine, spoolie-oolie, why don't you pass that bottle of wine? Hey, Nick, Jerry, the gift was just fine. Thanks.
Hello, I'm going to read two poems. The first one is called Goodbye. There are things I know I can not have, and it hurts to know you and to know I cannot have you, though I wish and I want and would like to, but no, I cannot, not you, not yes, yes, no, so goodbye. I am sorry, goodbye. Goodbye, you. I stay my fate, my own lone history. I drink the buoyant breezes alone, marvel at the sparkling skies, stars alone, wait on the curb for the lights alone. I am the last to know whom I love. I know now that you crave me as I craved you, all alone, all along, all along, all alone, all alone, all long, all longing for you, forlorn for you for so long, so long. The words are an alarm. I awaken to my sad self. Be good, be gone. I long alone and long alone shall be alone, long alone shall be though not alone, and so on and on and on. Goodbye, bye. I remember when I knew you. For one night we embraced. I've encased the night forever. It's in my you museum. One night, one night, one night we danced a long time ago. We shall go no more though my body craves your pounding. It is not to be, not know, never shall it know, not know, never shall it know yours or borrow or breathe breath just left your body or nor see you sleep nor know the luxury of how you smile. Wow, I mean, whoa, oh, how shall I contain this from now on? And in what chamber shall I stash my secrets? How sequester you, our words, our openness and hope? I who long ago forgot what one can do for one another, to one another, with one another. Go, be gone before I remember. Remember. May I remember? Shall I as now know or go in green or must? I must I? Goodbye or bye, good, good, bye. This poem is called The Bug in the Bath. I'm in my robe, I'm ready to disrobe when I see it, the bug in the bathtub. It's big, brown, and shiny like a loafer. It makes me think of you. And the pretty things your wife said at the dinner party, at the dinner table too, and rapt guests. I recall the amazed way she relayed your habit of sparing things, saving things. You rescue insects, take them tenderly to a new home, a safe one, out of doors when you find them in the house. Spiders, moths, beetles, even the solitary roach have in you a champion. In all the years she's known you, she has never seen you kill. We sighed and smiled and we raised our globe-like glasses to you, haloed in the candlelight. But I will kill the bug in the tub and so scoff off your hold on me. I will squash, smash and squish, stifle and suffocate, obliterate the bug that's bugging me, the idea of adultery. The water bug shall die by drowning, I decree, and watch it, ready to end it, waiting while the willing water rises. Meanwhile, from a pile of papers nearby, the obituary of a poet catches my eye. Standing by, I read it. If you're a poet, you're a poet first, the newly dead poet famously said. I glance now and then at the dumb insect. I know I am its executioner. It climbs the white slope again, slips again. It does not scream, it simply starts again. I know I am its executioner. It cannot fathom nor imagine me. If it could, surely it would. abandon the Sisyphean task and do battle with me more than porcelain, the enemy. I cannot have you usurp my mind, but I start to admire the water bug. I am no tenant in your moral world, but I feel tender towards this tentacled thing. The poet also seems to intercede. So I will stay the execution, and suddenly all about me in the air, palpable and pulsing, everywhere air, I perceive pity, mercy, and restraint. Forgive me, for did I forget, confuse my little ache for you with an ache for God? The water bug shall live, and I am glad. Now I want to shower the bug with love. I will take it tenderly out the door, kneeling. I use the obituary and a glass. I offer sanctuary. In my white robe in the dooryard, I pause to contemplate and evaluate. I seek its most amenable heaven. A sunny step, a galaxy of twigs, or that luminous green plate. Yes, a new leaf. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Can you guys hear me okay? All right, very good. All right, I'm gonna open this up to the house. If you guys, if the house has any questions whatsoever, just raise your hand. Sharon, I see your hand is up. I'm not sure if it was from before or after. So I'm gonna ask one quick question, and then we're gonna go into everybody else. I'm also going to turn on the chat and the Q&A. So any of you guys who would like to jump in, you could type something into the chat, or you can ask through the Q&A, or you could raise your hand. So whatever you like, and we're just going to go for a couple minutes. So my question to you guys, and anybody can jump into this, is so I know all of you guys, and you're all multidisciplinary. You have multiple disciplines in what you do. Actor, writer, playwright, poet. Do you sit down to actually, if you're a playwright, do you sit down to write poetry and vice versa? Or do you assign time to be a playwright? Do you assign time to be a musician? Do you assign time to be a lyricist? Assign time to be a poet? I'm very curious about that. Anybody can chime in, whoever wants to go first. Shirley.
When the idea strikes, I sit down and write. I don't have assigned time, just when the moment, someone may say a word to me, I may hear something on the TV, and I go for it. Yeah, and it works for me. Yeah.
Got it.
And by the way, I want to thank you for including me in this wonderful group. Oh. Everyone was marvelous. It was a very special occasion. Thank you.
It was wonderful. Great way to start a new year. So I'm thrilled. Anybody else want to chime in?
I think that they're all connected, you know, like if you're doing a play, for example, and, you know, you're working with a playwright and you're working with a director and you're working with other actors, you're working with language. So doing that can inspire song, you know, and it can inspire music, and the theater can inspire all these expressions of poetry. Is something that has to come out of you. It's something in the moment that you catch. I guess a lot you can go for the discipline, but I think the discovery of it is in the moment. I think all of those, whether I'm not painting or whatever it is. I know I'm not a painter, but I'm sure that if you're a painter and you're a writer, that's connected in somehow, you know. Mm-hmm. So I think they all, for me, that it kind of dovetails each other, you know, and that's my two cents, you know, and that's my story. I'm going to stick to it.
but as a writer, if you say, I'm going to sit down and write a story about XYZ, in my brain, the poet doesn't do that. The poet is however they're moved at that particular moment. Or am I wrong? Or does the poet say, you know what, today is my glass day? Don, please.
Yeah, I definitely sit down to write poetry. I don't necessarily know what I'm going to write, but I will, and I will start with a prompt, often just to see what comes out. So like the one that I wrote, Angels, was I went out, I took the entire day, I went and sat outside a coffee shop, and I wrote and I drank coffee and that came out. I didn't, and the prompt was Angels, and I had no idea what was going to come out. And it was less about angels than it was about freedom. But again, it's not a I go out specifically to write poetry without knowing. Sometimes I have an inspiration, and sometimes I'm like, I have to write that poem. Right. Sometimes I've had an assignment to write a poem. Please write something about this. But I definitely go out and specifically take time and say, I'm going to write, but I don't know what's going to come out.
Got it. Poetry, you work with a lot of young people. And for those who don't know, poetry also has the largest spoken word. Would you call it?
Venue
in the country called the, tell me again, poetry.
The Poetry Lounge?
Largest in the country. And it will, is it just closed because of COVID now? Or?
Yeah, man, we're in a, I'm worried. I'm like, oh gosh, we haven't been going on. We do some stuff online as well. But the theaters, you know, we get 500 people a night when we were doing
it. Right. So what
do you worried, think? I'm worried that after this COVID thing is finally over, that people are going to find something else to do. But I'm always worried. I don't know.
Likewise. But no, not if we get hot, but we'll do everything we can to fill your space again. So, but poetry, my question is, what do you tell young people? Like what, you know, as far as sitting down to work or sitting down, I mean, carry a pad, or how is it that you inspire young people to capture their thoughts?
Well, I say, because I teach workshops too, and every day I tell them to write what's in their heart and just write whenever they get a chance. If something hits them, you got to have a pen, or nowadays you have your phone. You just write down a little something to what remind you what that poem is. Because if you don't, you'll forget it and it'll be all over. Because I don't know how many times I've said, I'm gonna write that when I get home, and I never write it, and I forget it, and it's gone. So write even just a note down, a poem about bugs, you know, and write bugs down, and then there you go. That's what I tell people.
Got it. And Buffy, did poetry just recently find you, or is this something? Because I know you're on your second career, or you're.
Yeah, I mean, I was a movie executive for my whole adult life, but while I was doing that, I was also writing, but mostly prose. I've done a couple of novels, and I would say in the last maybe 6-7 years, I've really started to explore poetry in a serious way. And I agree with poetry. I mean, I send myself a dozen emails a day. Sometimes I don't know what they mean when I read them. Right. But just so you don't lose the, generally it's an image, just so you don't lose it.
Right, got it. And David, what's your process? You're working a lot these days. Is this when you're in the trailer and you're not on stage at the moment, or how's it working out?
Usually I'm so kind of restless when I'm working. I pace. I wear out soles of shoes. For me, I'm not very disciplined, but it always comes to me just when I slow down. When I actually slow down, that's when something will hit me and it'll just sort of, you know, flow through me. I don't, that's how it happens for me. I think I should try and sit and do that. And just because I think the discipline would be good, but it's not. What they've always just kind of overtaken me. It's like, you know, so.
And I know you, I mean, because we go back, so I know you as someone who actually reads poetry as well quite a bit. It's not, you're not just sitting down. So is this the art of poetry, has this been something of yours, a passion of yours for many years, and then you decided to put pen to paper?
Yeah, you know, I haven't written lately. The ones I read tonight were some very old stuff that I had. But there's something about even reading poetry, even if you just read it for yourself out loud and let the words just kind of wash over you. There's something that happens in that, you know, not trying to make sense out of it, not trying to analyze it, you know, because a lot of it, you don't know what it the reference is to, but it doesn't matter. I think that's what's so beautiful about poetry, is it can kind of just, it's a stimulus and you are the response, you know? So it's like call and response.
Right.
Yeah.
Hannah, I see you nodding a lot. So is it, so as a, and you know, I know you both as an actor and as a writer, of which I enjoy both. So your poetry is that, one is I'm amazed at how quickly you write. Is that just you or?
Yeah, it helps to be pissed about something. for me, no, I mean, I respond really well to prompts and deadlines. I've always been able to write pretty fast, but honestly, just, you know, fear, anger. so like a good deadline and being really worked up about something is really what works really well for me. But also, I can start out and I'll think, I'm going to write, you know, like a short story. It turns into poetry. I'm going to write a poem. It turns into a screenplay. So that's sort of my best laid plans. I mean, last week I sat down to write a poem and it turned into a fairy tale. So, you know, I just sometimes will have like nothing. I'll sit down a journal and then I end up, you know, writing something weird. So, but for me, it does actually help to have some arbitrary deadline. Like you called and I was like, I guess I'm gonna write some poetry this week. And then it was like Christmassy, New Year's, and right. You know, obviously I have an opinion. So that helped, you know. So, and then there's things come, you know, I believe there are magical mystery muses, you know, and they come through different versions of us in different ways for a reason. That's sort of my theory.
Right. Devin, do you, when you sit down, because as a playwright and a very active playwright and someone who also works with quite a few students, do you ever sit down to write one thing and find yourself writing something else?
All the time. I feel like, if I had to categorize, actually everything, I identify with every single writer here and every single comment and every single sort of process. But if I had to sort of categorize in terms of poetry, I would say that I have two sort of modes in poetry. One is, very personal. Like the poems I read today were super personal, like almost like when I want to write in code or secret, it's like becomes a poem, you know, it becomes like I have to invent this language to say what I want to say. And the other thing that often inspires me is something Hannah was just saying, is being really bothered. Like I remember when Newtown happened, I couldn't sleep. I just woke up in the middle of the night and I wrote for 3 days. The same with 9/11. I just wrote for about 2 weeks about 9/11, or like our 2016 election, the same thing. I mean, so sometimes it's civic and sometimes it's secret for me. Those are sort of the two, modes, but everything everyone has said, I totally identify with, like the beauty of reading, you know, it just something happens, you just want to respond, or sending yourself emails or sitting in a coffee shop, or, you know, I identify with all of those things.
Got it. And Michael, we have not forgotten about you. So your piece was almost long form. Is that something that you have been working on for some time? Is that how your brain works, or just
something? I've never thought of myself as a poet ever. This story, I started writing as a story. Then it turned into a poem. Then it turned into a song, actually. Mm. It's a song that I've actually recorded. But it's just it's a great story, and it enabled me to fool around with rhyming couplets, which I never really thought about it at all. It just literally, it took about a few days. I just started happening. My brother had started writing music and songs, and I think maybe that kind of gave me a little impetus, and it just came out. And I don't think I've ever written anything else like this since then. Mm. It was just great fun writing it. Just finding, okay, how can I make this? How can I make that work? Oh yeah, that's nice, that's nice. It was really a joy to do and to record and to read. It was fun.
Beautiful. Let me just, a couple comments, and that is, we have Steve Hoffendahl. Thanks, that was welcome and wonderful. Elizabeth Yoakum, a poet is a poet first. Alan Blumenfeld, wonderful to get to know these poets, most especially Buffy, who continues to amaze me and inspire me. And Cavanaugh, just excellent. Is that a song as well as a poem? Kevin Kelly, great to see you. And thank you to all of the poets. Rick Sandek says, Devin, Bug in the Bath, that was great. And Herb Mendelson, great work, Hannah. Hi from Herbert. Poetry, now I can be marvelous just like you. Mm-hmm. That's wonderful. Well, guys, if anybody has any other questions or thoughts out in the audience, please raise your hand. Otherwise, I'm going to ask anybody here if you have any parting words for us. Buffy, please.
I just wanted to build on what some of the, or almost all the poets said, and I was honored to be with the group, and they were so different. I read a lot of poetry, contemporary poetry, and old poetry too, but contemporary. And there's kind of a mix of disciplines now. What is poetry? What is microfiction? There's these hybrid things. I mean, even the novel, I think it's called Chinatown, uses screenplay convention. So I think there's a lot of freedom to meld the disciplines, even bringing in visual arts, or I think someone said music, into what used to be a kind of narrow form of poetry. I think it's really bigger and more accessible. And the fact that you did this tonight was just tremendous. And I really appreciate it.
It was an honor. It's been an honor.
Yes, I want to chime in there. I want to say, Todd, thank you. Thank you for assembling us. Thank you for listening, so that all of us we can join together, but in the entire audience. And it's been an incredible year, an incredible season. So just fantastic.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure and an honor, believe me. Hannah.
So I have a little call. I have a little something I wanted to share that I shared with you.
Sure.
So this year, as we are called upon to stand up, speak out, step forward, we will be tempted to lay down, roll over, do nothing, turn out the light, press the snooze button on the alarm. But before we reach for comfort, bleary-eyed, let us pause, and may we feel the ashes of the dead that remain on our lashes, taste the lies told by their killers in our mouths, and hear the murmurs of those in our mouths who have no voices now, who simply needed someone to be that somebody, to do something.
Hannah.
You're here.
Sharon Gold.
Thank you, Hannah.
I don't know if this was an old hand or a new hand. Sharon, are you here?
Yeah, but I didn't have my hand up.
You have a hand up, but it's always good to hear your voice. Okay. All right. Thank you for joining us, Hannah. Sharon.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you all so much.
All right, we're going to go to Gina Acosta.
Hi, you guys. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hey, happy, happy new year. I'm again, Todd, thank you so much for assembling this amazing group of wonderful poets. I'm kind of an admitted poet phobe myself, I don't know much about it, but I love, this was wonderful. This was to hear language, to hear and feel these images as I believe David said, just, it washed over me and it was a wonderful shower to take on this first day of the new year. And so I cannot thank each of you enough for what a wonderful gift. Thank you. And I really, really hope, Todd, that you would do another evening like this again.
Oh, great.
But just to hear this wonderful language and these beautiful images and thank you. And Hannah, your final poem that you just was stunning. So thank you for giving us that one more wonderful dose. Thank you. Thank you guys all so, so much. Happy, happy new year. And I can't wait to hear more from you guys. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, Gina. Happy new year to you. Okay, everybody. We've gone a few minutes over to all of the poets. First of all, happy new year. And thank you guys so much for tonight. It was brilliant. I'm going to send you guys a quick link, by the way. As soon as we wrap up, check your email. And that's basically just a moment where we could all gather and just say hi and thank you, just to wrap up, it's a quick wrap up. To everybody else out in the audience, Rick, thank you so much. It says, Todd, smartphone is a hit, love poems on Valentine's. Oh, there you go.
Love yeah. Poems.
Wow, okay.
Got a few of those.
We can work that out. Okay, so to our audience, happy new year, safe. Safe holiday, safe year, much happiness. And thank you guys for everything, for an incredible 2020. And we're looking forward to a powerful 2021 of health and happiness, really. Okay.
Thank you, Todd.
Mask up. We'll stay safe and mask up.
Yes, absolutely. We'll see you soon. Thanks, everybody. Take care.